Thank you. I am thankful to the organizer for the invitation. Happy to be here. And this time I'm going to speak. My talk is related to combinatorics of words. Namely, I'm speaking about identities in groups. And you know, this area used to be trendy, but now I am starting with some basic definitions. Namely, a variety of groups is a class of groups given by a set of identical relations. Say, the variety of form abelian groups is given by the obvious identity. The Burnside variety BN also is given by a single identity X to N is 1. The variety of nilpotent groups of class at most C, this long commutator, similar to the variety of metabelian groups and varieties of soluble groups of length at most N and so on. And in general, so identity looks like a word from a free group, so free group of infinite rank, arbitrary word equal to 1. And G belongs to the variety if and only if the verbal subgroup corresponding this set of words is trivial, but in arbitrary group, the verbal subgroup by definition is generated by all values of the words from this system. It is derived subgroup for the variety of abelian groups. It is generated. It is generated by all nth powers. If we consider the variety of the variety BN of the Burnside variety, and so on. In every variety, we have free groups, and a free group of rank M of the variety can be obtained as follows. We have the free, absolutely free group in the usual sense, and factorize it over the verbal subgroup corresponding to this variety. If you have arbitrary group, you can consider the variety generated by this group, the minimal variety containing this group. A number of examples. If I take infinite cyclic groups, then the variety generated by this group is the variety of all abelian groups. If I take a cyclic group of order n, then the variety generated by this group is given by two identities. The identity which says that the group must be abelian, and this identity says that the exponent is n or divided by n. The variety generated by symmetric group of degree 3, all identities follow from two identities. This one, the exponent is 6, and arbitrary two squares must commute. The variety generated by the quaternion group of order 8, this is the basis of the identity, that is arbitrary identity, is a consequence of these two identities.
So could you go one side? So for example, for symmetric group, mm-hmm. you take a free group with arbitrary many generators, and if you kill this vector subgroup, you will be the symmetric group, no matter how many generators I started with.
Well, yes, I obtain a free group in the variety generated by the symmetric group. For example, the free group in this variety generated by two elements has order 972, the free group, for example. S3 is not free group in the variety generated by itself. Up. So all the examples were finitely based. Each of the variety was given by a finite set of identities. And there are many examples and results about such varieties, finitely based variety. Every nilpotent variety, so sub-variety of NC, is finitely based, according to Lindl. Every metabelian variety is finitely based. And if we have a group with nilpotent derived subgroup, then again, the variety generated by this group is finitely based. A variety generated by a finite group is finitely based, and this result is difficult, and use the theory of finite groups. For example, the analog for semigroups fails. There is a semigroup with six elements and without finite basis of identities. No question raised by Bernard Neumann whether every group variety finitely based. And in 1969, negative answers were given by these three authors, independently with very short interims, all of them used different methods. Me constructed some finite solvable groups of derived length 5. Adian applied the technique of Novikov and Adian for theory of periodic words. Von Lee used two groups. Well, now about an example. This is a simple example of a system of identity which is not equivalent to any finite system of identity, independently obtained by Bryant and Roger Bryant and Yuri Kleiman. You see that arbitrary identity in this series in fact follows from the next one, because we can replace the last variable by one. The group generated by all squares, the subgroup generated by all squares, belongs to the Bernstedt variety of exponent 4 here. So the group satisfies this series of identities if and only if it has a normal subgroup belonging to B4 such that the factor group belongs to B2. In other words, this set of identities define the product of two varieties, B4 and B2. In general, the product of two varieties by definition consists of all groups having a normal subgroup in U, such as the factor group belongs to V. And the product is again a variety. For example, the variety of metabelian group is A times A from this definition. So Kleiman and Bryant solved a problem, another problem of Hahn and Neumann. Is this true that a product of two finitely based variety is also finitely based? No, this is a counterexample. But if we consider two Bernstedt varieties of relatively prime exponents, then I'm leaving this for exercise. Prove that all the identities fall from this single identity. A product of 2n's power, 2m, is 1. So if the exponents are relatively prime, then it suffices to take just one identity. But if the exponents are not relatively prime, the picture is completely different. And Kleiman generalized his example as follows. Given arbitrary prime P, given arbitrary prime P, the product of the Burnside variety times arbitrary variety C is not finitely based if the exponent n, the exponent n is divisible by P squared. And and this assumption was essential, and I will explain that exponent and the following was unknown. If you take BP times BP, where P is a prime number, is it true that this variety finitely based? Or it is not true. In particular, that problem was raised in a survey by Gupta and Krasilnikov. And it is true if for small p's, say p is 2 or 3, but the theorem is in our this joint work with Nick Boatman, who was a graduate student at Vanderbilt, we proved that for sufficiently large prime p, this product BP times BP is not finitely based. So in other words, this system of identities is not equivalent to any finite system of identities. A stronger form of this theorem, this BP times BP has infinite axiomatic rank. This means that we cannot define this variety using, say, 100 variables. We need infinitely many variables to define this variety. If we use method of Clayman and Bryant, say, to prove that BP squared times BP is not, we in fact use solvable groups of bounded solvable lengths. And this is not, now if for BP times BP, this method does not work for the following reason. On the one hand, the intersection of BP and arbitrary solvable variety is a nilpotent variety. It was known for a long time due to Tobin. And Higman proved that a product of a nilpotent variety times arbitrary finitely based variety, say BP, must be finitely based. So, we need a different approach here, and some words about the proof. First step. For the first step, we need some finite p group. So we fix an odd prime p and construct some auxiliary finite p groups, namely for arbitrary positive integer m, we construct a finite p group u with two properties. First property, the subgroup u to p, that is the subgroup generated by all p powers of the elements, is central subgroup, and the exponent of u is p squared. And most important, the second property, you know, by definition, u to p is generated. Arbitrary element from u to p is a product of p of powers, p powers. But for given m, we have an element, non-trivial element g in this subgroup, and such that this element cannot be expressed as a product of m powers. So first of all, we need these auxiliary finite groups. Such groups can be obtained as some unit triangle groups of dimension p plus 1 over a tensor algebra, so arbitrary elements is a multilinear mapping over Galois field. Important remark here that all these groups are nilpotent of class P, and we cannot use for our goal the groups of smaller nilpotency class, because all of them, if the class is less than P, arbitrary such a P group is regular. And in this group, arbitrary product of P powers is again a power, it's itself a power. Then the second step. And for the second step, we need a construction of torsion groups. You know, there are various constructions of torsion groups due to Gold-Shafarevich, to Grigorchuk, to if exponent is finite, to Novikov and Andian, and so on. Here I use my old approach. I use this inductive construction earlier to construct some so-called monsters or non-abelian torsion groups and many other examples. Here, a simplification of the construction, because now I need only all relations are just powers. Okay, so to construct the limit group G infinity, I add new relations step by step to the free group. So I start. I start with the free group over arbitrary alphabet, finite or infinite. So the set of relations R naught is empty. The set of so-called periods of rank zero is empty. And then by induction, so we assume that the group G I minus 1 is already constructed. So this set is already defined, and all sets of periods of smaller ranks are defined. And to make inductive step, I need one more slide. Namely, given I, arbitrary integer I, Xi is a maximal subset of words in the alphabet satisfying two conditions. Every word from this set has length I and has infinite order in the previous group. Infinite order. One condition. And the second one, so our choice should be thrifty. Two different words from this Xi are not conjugated in the previous group. And these words are called periods of rank I. And for arbitrary period, we fix now an odd integer n sub a, sufficiently large enough, so greater than some constant n zero. We add new relations. Here, Si consists of all powers of this periods with prescribed exponent. So the new set of relations functions is defined as the union of the previous one and this SI. And so the next group GI is defined here. And this is an inductive approach. There are many properties of these periods, of these groups of this type. I need only two properties in the proof. The first property, every element of the limit group is conjugate to a power of some period. It's conjugate to a power of some period. And the second property, that every period has order exactly na, not smaller. Only two properties I need to the next step of our proof. Where is this? So main construction is following. Given arbitrary, so we fix a prime P, sufficiently large P. We choose an integer M, so we have that finite group U, U dependent on P and M. Recall that the subgroup U to P has a special element such that it is not a product of M's power, and moreover, every element except for one in this cyclic subgroup is not such a product. And now we consider arbitrary free group F and some epimorphism onto U, some epimorphism. Because the definition will be dependent on this automorphism. Consider the subgroup H generated by all P's powers in F. Of course, this is a subgroup of free group. H is free itself. And so the construction of the second step I described earlier can be applied to H. And I do this. H has a free basis, infinite free basis. And starting with this basis, I construct by induction the group GIs, starting with H, not with F. I'm sorry. But the definition of the exponents NA for the periods depends on the mapping F I introduce from F to U. And this is a definition. If image of the period belongs to U to P, but not does not belong to the distinguished cyclic subgroup, or F of A is 1, then the exponent is P, and otherwise it is P squared. And using the properties of periods and the property of this auxiliary finite group, we can prove the following lemma. This main lemma is formulated here. Consider the kernel of the canonical mapping from H to the limit group. Of course, the kernel is normal in H because it is kernel. But it turns out that it is normal in the whole free group F, and the quotient of F over this kernel satisfies the identity, this identity with M variables, but does not belong, this quotient does not belong to the product BP times BP, and this is the end of our proof. For arbitrary M, we are able to construct such a quotient LM, and it follows that the product BP times the BP cannot be defined by a finite set of variables. Well, I will not speak about axiomatic rank. One more theorem about basis rank of this product. Basis rank of a variety is D by definition if the variety can be generated by its D generated groups, but cannot be generated by D minus one generated groups. And the theorem says that the basis rank of this product BP times BP is 2. And to compare, I formulate this remark that BN times BN have infinite basis if, say, N is small, 2, 3, 4, or 6. And to prove theorem 3, we prove a new theorem about basis rank of arbitrary product of varieties. We use the following notion. No, not this one. A group G is called discriminated by a group D if for every finite subset in G we have a homomorphism onto G injective or even into G injective on S. Yes, no theorem here, just a corollary of our theorem. If we have any variety such that the free group of infinite rank is discriminated by some M-generated group D from this variety, then for arbitrary variety U, the free group in the product U times V is discriminated by M plus one generated group from this variety. And it follows that the basic rank of the product does not exceed M plus one. I am formulating this corollary now because if I replace M plus one by two M plus one, then the statement can be found in old book of Hannah Neumann. It was for two M plus one, this statement was proved by Baumslag and three Neumanns 50 years ago. Hannah Neumann mentioned in her book that under some additional assumption, they can prove the statement for M plus one. But in our corollary, we need no additional assumptions. So, Now, about partial identity, partial Burnside group. I suggest the following definition. Assume we have a group satisfying two conditions. The first one, the group can be given by a set of relations of this type. Wi is arbitrary words, but we have some nth power. First condition, and second, every element of finite order in G has order dividing n. Let's call such a group partial Burnside group. Some obvious example, say absolutely free group is partial Burnside because the set of relations is just empty. Free Burnside group is partial Burnside. Free product of two cyclic groups of order n is partial Burnside, of course. Two more interesting examples. Next example, take arbitrary normal subgroup in a free group such that factor group is torsion free and consider the subgroup generated by all nth powers from n, from this normal subgroup. Well, then, I missed. I wanted to say here, sorry, that the factor group of F over N capital to N is partial Burnside over cap. And one more example. Again, F is a free group over arbitrary alphabet. And F to N from the left be the subgroup generated by nth powers of all words with the property that this word does not belong this verbal subgroup, does not belong this verbal subgroup. And for large odd n, the group, the factor group of this is partial Burnside. Why is this example interesting? You know that it is easy to see that this subgroup is characteristic subgroup just because this one is characteristic subgroup in F. But it is not fully characteristic. It is not invariant under all endomorphism because the factor group, this factor group, contains non-cyclic free subgroups. And you know that the problem, it was known problem for a time. Is it true that the free group of infinite, in the free group of infinite rank, arbitrary characteristic subgroup is fully characteristic? So this is a counterexample to that. Problem. And about some properties of partial Burnside group. I formulated this notion and suggested to Nick Boatman to investigate such partial Burnside group. Now I want to say a few words about his result because after his defense he immediately left mathematics and went to some insurance business, and I think it will never speak of his results. So I want to formulate some his results.
Can you show me his photo?
Sorry. So given arbitrary partial Burnside group and arbitrary non-cyclic subgroup, then it contains a non-cyclic partial Burnside group of partial exponent n. So in every non-cyclic subgroup, we have such partial Burnside, moreover, of infinite rank even. In particular, every non-cyclic torsion subgroup of partial Burnside group contains a non-cyclic free Burnside group of exponent n, and again, I should add of infinite rank, with infinite set of generators. Every non-cyclic torsion-free subgroup of partial Burnside group contains a non-cyclic free subgroup. So these groups are between free Burnside groups and free groups. Two more results of Nick Boatman. If we take a non-cyclic, finitely presented subgroup of partial Burnside group, then it must contain non-cyclic, absolutely free subgroup, arbitrarily finitely presented subgroup. And similar, arbitrarily finitely presented group of free Burnside group of sufficiently large odd exponent is cyclic, according to this. So a number of results about subgroups. And now one algorithmical statement. about partial Bjornstad groups of large odd partial exponent. The following properties are equivalent. The algorithmic word problem is decidable, solvable in G, and the conjugacy problem is solvable in G in partial Bjornstad group. And both these statements are equivalent to the property that the set of words representing finite order elements is recursive. Is recursive. It's about Boatman's results and one more result about subgroups of free Bjornstad groups. There is no analog of Nielsen-Schreier property unless n is equal, the exponent is 2. The free Bjornstad group of large odd exponents contains many free Bjornstad subgroups. The first non-trivial example was constructed by Adian long time ago. Say, if you take free Bjornstad group with 2 generators, we can embed into this group free Bjornstad group with 3 generators. Say, if I take arbitrary proper subgroup of finite index, it is not free Bjornstad. For arbitrary proper subgroup of finite index in the free Bjornstad group, we know that it is not free Bjornstad. And I want to finish with a recent result in our joint paper with Dennis Osin. Some new construction we needed. If we have arbitrary finite or infinite family of non-trivial elements in free Bjornstad groups, arbitrary family, then we can find some conjugator F1, F2, such that the conjugate elements H1, H2, and so on, freely generate, so form a free basis of a free Bjornstad subgroup. Of course, we need the conditions that the elements of this, all these elements have order n, not smaller. But if n is prime, then we can, of course,
conditions inside except the Bjornstad subgroup be isomorphic to B and N, the same exponent.
Same exponent. If n is prime, of course, arbitrary non-trivial element is of order n. But in the second statement, just arbitrary elements of arbitrary orders, non-trivial, then we can find F1, F2 such that this commutators freely generate a free Bjornstad subgroup. And we used these properties, we needed this construction to prove that so-called reduced C-star algebra of BMN is C-star simple algebra and has a unique trace, and that was an answer to the question of raised by Pierre de la Harpe. And one more corollary, arbitrary BMN, no, of course M is at least 2 here, the number of generators, contains, and N is sufficiently large, contains a subgroup isomorphic to the free Bjornstad group of infinite rank, and such that H has non-trivial intersection with every conjugacy class of BMN. Well, some recent results in this direction. I finished it.
We do. Thank you. Are there any questions?
No questions.
Okay. We'll thank again.